Thank you, the song leader, Mr. Kakenya Cook. Good morning, brother.
Good morning, sir.
Happy Sabbath.
To you.
I believe we all are happy to be here this morning. Brethren, it is truly a privilege to be in the presence of God, because it's not everyone that is opportune to be in the presence of God. For those opportune to be in the presence of God, it is a great privilege and it's worth to be rejoiced upon. I want to specially thank the first speaker, Mr. Clinton, for laying a good foundation to what I'm about to speak this morning. He spoke on the choices we make. It takes choice to be here this morning. It takes choice to serve God. It takes choice to respond to invitation. And I want to ask, how many of us have made choice to attend ceremony before? I believe many of us must have, in one way or the other, attended ceremony. Ceremony is beautiful. Ceremony is part of human life. Personally, I enjoy ceremony. Ceremony is heartwarming, and we have different kinds of ceremony. Ceremony like wedding ceremony, Thanksgiving ceremony, naming ceremony, and so on and so forth. Today, I am going to speak on ceremony. Not really ceremony that is of man or that is made by man, but ceremony that is made by God, also named by God, because God is also a lover of ceremony. At least we have instances where Jesus Christ attended a ceremony that is called wedding ceremony. So God is also a lover of ceremony. And that brings us to the title of this gospel sermon, which I titled Worship Ceremony. Worship ceremony. Brethren, one of the reasons that we are called is to attend the worship ceremony that God has ordained. The question is, how well do we understand what God expects you and I to do when we gather together for worship ceremony? It is one thing to worship God, and it is another thing to worship God the way He prescribed. If you and I worship God in our own way, it makes such worship a vain worship. But if you and I worship God the way He prescribed, it becomes a profitable worship. The question is, when we gather together for worship ceremony, what service, what duty do God expect you and I to perform? Do we just gather and go home? Or are we called to perform a service? And if you and I fail to understand those services that God expects you and I to perform when we gather together for worship ceremony, our worship becomes a vain. So let us see what service, what function God expects you and I to perform when we gather together for worship ceremony. Come with me for our first Bible reading to Luke, Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2. Reading from verse 41 to 42, so that we can understand the service that God expects you and I to perform when we gather together for worship ceremony, so that our worship will not be in vain. Acts of the Apostle, chapter 2, reading from verse 41 to 42. 41. Then those who gladly received his word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. 42. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and the fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in prayers. These are the four important services that God expects you and I to perform when we gather together for worship ceremony. God expects you and I to learn together. What are we to learn? Those doctrines that are passed on to the apostle and to us. The first service that God expects you and I to perform when we gather together for worship ceremony is to learn together. The second is to fellowship together. The third is to refresh together. Then the fourth is to pray together. Brethren, all these four services are important, and that is what makes our worship acceptable to God. So let us examine this four services one after the other. The Bible says that we should continue in the apostles' doctrine. That is, when we gather together for worship ceremony, God expects you and I to learn together. The question is, how much do we understand the doctrines of God? God expects you and I to grow in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible also encourages you and I to let the word of God richly dwell in us. And the Bible also tells us that we should not live by physical food alone, but by every word that comes out of the mouth of God. So God wants his word, his doctrines, to dwell in us, so that we can pass them to generations that are to come. As Clinton rightly pointed out, the choice to preserve the doctrine of God is what keeps the church of God alive. Because the difference between the first church and the true church is that the true church preserves the true doctrines of God. And how can we preserve the doctrines of God if you and I don't know those doctrines? The question is, what do we do when messages are going on? Do we understand that it is important for us to learn? Do we keep busy distracting? Do we keep busy watching some movie in our television, in our handset, while messages are going on? Brethren, learning together is an important aspect of service that God expects us to render when we gather together for worship ceremony. Brethren, the question is, those things which we practice, do we know the reason why we do the things we do? Do we know why we keep the Sabbath? Do we know why we don't eat certain food? Do we know why we do the things we do? The Bible says we should be willing to give answer to everyone that asks you and I the reason of the hope that is in us. James also encourages you and I to contend endlessly for the faith that was once delivered to the faith, to the saint. Brethren, God has made an avenue, opportunity for us to learn his doctrine. And that is why when we gather together for worship ceremony, we don't just gather for jamboree. We gather for important purpose. And one of that important purpose is to learn the doctrines of God. Turn with me again to 2 Timothy. 1 Timothy, sorry. Brethren, learning together It's an important service that God expects you and I to perform when we gather together for worship ceremony. 1 Timothy chapter 4. 1 Timothy chapter 4, reading from verse 16. Take heed to yourself and to the doctrine, continue in them, for in doing this you will save both yourself and those who hear you. God is speaking to us through Apostle Paul, though this was sent to Timothy. And Timothy is a servant of God, as you and I are also servants of God. God is instructing us to take heed, to learn his doctrine. And he said, by doing so, we will preserve our life and the life of others. So, brethren, do we make conscious effort to learn the doctrines of God? Because that is what separates us from those outside the church of God. Do we understand the true doctrines of God? Do we understand those things that God wants you and I to know so that you and I can be true disciples of Christ? The Bible says you shall know the truth. And what is the truth? The doctrines or the word of God. And it says those truths shall make you and I free. Turn again with me to Joshua chapter 1. Joshua chapter 1. Joshua chapter 1. Joshua chapter 1, reading verse 8. Joshua chapter 1, reading verse 8. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth. Which book is he talking about? That is the Holy Bible. He says, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth. For you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and you will have good success. For us to be successful in our quest to enter the kingdom of God, we must let the word of God richly dwell in us. And for the word of God to be richly dwell in us, we must make care to learn the word of God. And that is exactly what we are doing today. So brethren, one of the reasons that God invited us today is to learn his word, to learn his doctrine, so that we can preserve them and pass them to our children and those that will come after us. The second service that God expects you and I to perform when we gather together for worship ceremony is to fellowship together. One might say, what God really wants me to do if I come together, if we come together for worship ceremony, is just to study, to learn his word, and go home. What is my business to fellowship together? Brethren, fellowship together is an important service that God expects you and I to perform when we gather together for worship ceremony. Because as we read in Acts, he says we should continue in the apostles' doctrine and we should continue in fellowship. God wants you and I to build one united family. God wants you and I to know each other. God wants you and I to unite with one another. And he has made an available opportunity for us to do so, and that is to fellowship. Brethren, how well do we know each other? Do we truly know each other? It is one thing to gather together, to learn together, and it is another thing to fellowship together. The Bible says, iron sharpens iron. Brethren, the road, our calling cannot be successful with us enough if you and I place individual if think we can do it individually. God wants us to understand that we are called to partner together, and that is the best way we can succeed in our calling. So to fellowship together is an important service that God expects you and I to perform. The question is, what are we to each other? Are we brothers and sisters to each other? Or are we strangers to each other? Who is a brother? A brother is one whom you are related with. And who is a stranger? A stranger is one whom you don't know. If you and I don't know each other, it simply means that we are strangers to each other, and we have failed the purpose why God brings us together. God wants you and I to be brothers to each other. And God says, Jesus Christ says, by this all we know that you are my disciple, if you love one another, if you unite with one another. Brethren, to fellowship together is an important service that God expects you and I to perform when we gather together for worship ceremony. Turn again with me to the book of Hebrews, chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10. Jesus Christ says, let them be one as we are one. Brethren, for you and I to be one, we must learn to fellowship together. The Bible says, there is a general saying that communication brings harmony. If you and I communicate with one another, it will strengthen us to know each other so that we can fulfill one of the reasons why God brings you and I together. Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10, reading verse 24. And let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good work. Let us fellowship with one another so that we can encourage each other in love and good work. Brethren, we understand the importance of fellowshipping together. We should desist from the habit of not trying to fellowship together. If you and I think that why we are called is only to learn the word of God and go home, we are making a great mistake. That means that we are not truly worshiping God the way He prescribed. God wants you and I to learn together, to fellowship together, so that our worship to God will be acceptable to Him. Turn again with me to 1 John chapter 1. 1 John chapter 1. Reading verse 7. 1 John chapter 1, reading verse 7. For if we walk in the light as He is in the light, and we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from all our sin. One of the conditions that will make the blood of Christ to be profitable to us is when we walk in the light and have fellowship with one another. What does it mean to walk in the light? To practice righteousness and to fellowship with one another, so that the blood of Christ will be profitable to us, to cleanse us from all and our sins. Brethren, our fellowship with one another is very, very important. The Bible even gave it to us here as a condition that will make our sins to be cleansed. It says, if we walk in the light, if we practice righteousness, and then fellowship with one another, our sins will be cleansed. So, brethren, let us not disregard the service of fellowshipping together, for it is important to God. The third service that God expects you and I to perform when we gather together for worship ceremony is to eat and wine together. The Bible says we should continue in the apostles' doctrine. We should continue in fellowship. And we should continue in breaking of bread. When the Bible is talking about breaking of bread, what does it mean? It simply means refreshment. It simply means feasting together. It simply means eating and wining together. This is the aspect that our pastor, Mr. Dare, have tried to convince us, but we seem not to be getting him right. Maybe we think it is not part of the requirement of today, but the Bible has made it clear to us that it is part of today's requirement to refresh together. The question is, do we understand the importance of eating together on the Sabbath day, or do we think it is not necessary? Brethren, we should not worship God in our own way. We should worship God the way He prescribed. The Bible says that God rested on the seventh day, and He also refreshed. The question is, what does it mean for God to refresh? It simply means that God celebrated. Brethren, today is not a day of mourning. It is a day of celebration. So refreshment is part of the requirement of today. The question is, who is to provide the refreshment? The pastor and the wife? The deacon and the wife? Or those who are handy among us? Who are to provide the refreshment? Because eating together on a Sabbath day is an important requirement that God expects you and I to perform when we gather together for worship ceremony. Who is to provide the refreshment? Let the Bible speak for itself. Exodus chapter 34. Exodus chapter 34, let us start reading from verse 20. Exodus 34, reading from verse 20. For the firstborn of a donkey you shall redeem with a lamb, and if you will not redeem him, then you shall break his neck. All the firstborn of your sons you shall redeem. Mark the next phrase, and he says, and none shall appear before me empty-handed. God says, we, his worshippers, should not appear before his presence empty-handed. One might argue by saying, oh, not to appear before the presence of God empty-handed is referring to the high Sabbath or the yearly Sabbath, but it is far from the truth. The next verse will tell us the particular Sabbath that God is talking about. Let's read verse 21. 6 days you shall walk, but on the seventh day you shall rest. In plowing time and in harvest time you shall rest. So it's not talking about the yearly Sabbath, is talking about the weekly Sabbath, that we should not appear before his presence empty-handed. We should try as much as possible not to neglect this important service, because whatever we bring on the Sabbath day like this is for our own refreshment. We are not going to dash them to anybody to take home. We are going to use them for our own enjoyment. So God has made it a compulsory service for us to perform, to eat and to wine together. And He has made available how those refreshments should be made available by you and I coming to service, not with empty hands. Turn with me again to Luke chapter 14. brethren, eating together on a Sabbath day is an important service that God expects you and I to perform, so that you and I should not worship God in a way that is not acceptable to Him. He expects you and I to learn together, to fellowship together, to eat and to wine together. Luke chapter 14. Reading from verse 1. Now it happened that he went into the house. He here is referring to Jesus Christ. He says, now it happened as he went into the house of one of the rulers of the Pharisees to do what? To eat bread on the Sabbath, that they washed him closely. Jesus Christ is not just going to the Pharisees' house or the ruler of the Pharisees just because he is hungry, but because it is part of the requirement of the Sabbath for God's people to eat together. That is why the Bible says he went there to eat bread. Brethren, we should understand that eating together is an important service. There is a saying that a family that eats together stays together. You and I should not neglect this important service. Our pastor, Mr. Kimball, have been hammering on it. In outside the country, it is called potluck. It is part of the requirement. It is not just for a showcase. It is an important service that God expects you and I to perform, so that our gathering, our worship to God will not be in vain. It is one thing to worship God, and it is another thing not to worship God in vain. God expects you and I, when we gather together, to learn together, to fellowship together, to eat together. Finally, let us see the fourth service that God expects you and I to perform when we gather together for worship ceremony. The Bible says in the Acts of the Apostles we read earlier, it says we should continue in prayers. So to pray together is an important service that God expects you and I to perform when we gather together for worship ceremony. And the Bible is talking about prayer. He's talking about prayer simply means making supplication to God or giving thanks to God. Giving thanks to God is also called prayer in the Bible. And making supplication to God is also called prayer. So brethren, God expects you and I to pray together. For those who might argue that that the songs of praises is not prayer, let's just quickly pick our hymnals and see our Bible hymnal to hymn number 127. Hymn, please. I'm not trying to become a song leader. I just want to be. Hymn number 127. It says, "We will glorify." It's taken from Psalm 86. So let's turn to our Bible to Psalm 86. Psalm 86. What is the title in your own Bible? Do you have a title here? Mr. Lawrence?
The Prayer of David.
It says it's a prayer of David. That is what is recorded in one of our psalms. So that's to tell you that some of the songs we sing are prayers. Turn again to your Bible hymnal to page 48. Page 48 is our God, our help in ages past. And it says it's taken from Psalm 90. So let's turn to our Bible to Psalm 90. Psalm 90. What is the title in your? Do you have any title there?
The prayer of Moses, the son, the man of God.
He said it is a prayer of Moses, and it is called song. So that's to tell you and I that when we sing to God or when we make supplication to God, he's talking about prayers. How do God view our supplications? How do God view our songs of praises? Talk with me to Revelation chapter 5, so that we can understand how important is our supplication to God and our songs of praises. Because it is an important service that God expects you and I to perform when we gather together for worship ceremony. God expects you and I to learn together, to fellowship together, to eat and to wine together, and to pray together. So let us see how God views our supplications or our songs of praises. Revelation chapter 5, reading verse 8. Revelation 5, verse 8. Now, when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each having a harp and a gold bowl full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. The Bible helps us to understand that our supplications, our songs of praises are like an incense to God. It's an aroma that God likes to perceive. So the Bible encourages you and I to continue in the apostles' doctrine, to continue in fellowship, to continue in breaking of bread, and to continue in prayers. Prayers is an important service that God expects you and I to render when we gather together for worship ceremony. Turn again with me to 1 Thessalonians. Our prayer, our source of praises, they are an instance to God that God loves to perceive. So when we pray, when we sing to God, we are giving God the type of aroma that gladdens his heart. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, reading from verse 17 to 18. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, reading from verse 17 to 18. He says, pray without ceasing. 18. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. So we are encouraged to pray always and to give God thanks, to sing songs of praises to God. Brethren, these are the four important services that God expects you and I to perform when we gather together for worship ceremony. None of these services are of less importance. Each of them carries of the same weight of importance. You and I should not treat any of these same services that God expects you and I to render as if one are less important and one are of high importance. All of them are of a great importance. So brethren, let us learn to worship God in a way that is profitable to us, because he says that some worship him and worship him in vain. Those who keep Sunday are not, it's not referring to those who keep Sunday, because they are not worshiping God. They are not part of the flock of God. But he's talking to you and I. So it is one thing to worship God, and it is another thing not to worship God in vain. So God has made available to us the way we can worship him that will be profitable to us. So he encourages us to continue in prayer. He encourages us to learn together, to fellowship together, to eat and to wine together, and to pray together. These are the services that God expects you and I to perform when we gather together for worship ceremony. So brethren, let us make effort. Let us continue to worship God in a way that is acceptable to him. Let us not worship God in vain, for that will be of a great regret to us. So let us worship God the way he prescribed, by learning together, by fellowshipping together, by eating and wining together, and by praying together.